Illustration.
What was your major?
Biology. That's true. It's because I always wanted to study animals when I was a kid, and I always thought I'd be a biology major. But I went to a school where I could always do art also. So I finished my biology.
What's the name of the school?
St. Olaf College.
Okay.
Liberal Arts College. You've been there?
Yeah.
They have good art, good science. So I'd race off to the art department as soon as I got my bio done. That's great. So you're illustration people. This is my little studio. I don't live here, except when I work. And I've had this place for as long as my son has been around, so 17 years. And I live that way, 14 blocks. So it's nice. You know, sometimes I do take some things home, but even before I had this studio, I actually learned, I think, that it's helpful, probably not when you're students, but when you're working, to give yourself your own hours. Because the one thing you are in charge of as an illustrator is your own hours. I mean, you're in charge of your own time. You're not necessarily in charge of your own money, but you're in charge of your own time. So. The tendency is to just work all the time, you know, because you can, and you can stay up all night. But I finally found that I got more done if I gave myself regular hours, stopped for lunch. I used to go out for a walk after lunch every day. Don't do that anymore. But really split up my day carefully and then stop at 5. I'm not so good at that anymore.
Yeah.
But I used to. I used to always quit. Yeah. And...
Even
when this table was in the bedroom in our apartment. So I wanted to make a book about Charlie Parker. And initially I thought, well, I'll just do like a biography, and then thought, that's no good. I just want to try to capture a little bit of the flavor of it, of jazz. And so it's just very simple. Charlie Parker played bebop. Charlie Parker played saxophone. The music sounded like bebop. Never leave your cat alone. And so it goes on and repeats.
Bebop. Yep. Watercolor.
This is watercolor and charcoal pencil. And this is my first book. And
still in print?
Still in print. You know.
And I'm sorry, but Yo Yes?
Yo Yes was the next one.
This is a Caldecott Honor second book.
Yeah. So this one is just, I wanted to do a book about two kids meeting on the street maybe, and just do the whole thing in one or two word phrases back and forth. So it's yo, yes, hey, who, you, me, yes, you, oh, what's up? Not much, and so forth. And then they become friends. And this
Very simple.
Very simple, yeah.
But beautiful.
Yeah. Thank you. So these are, in some ways, these are my two best known books, and they're my very first books. Anyway, I thought I'd show you what I'm working on right now. I did a book a year ago, well, over the last 10 years, really, but it came out a year ago, which was a wordless picture book. And this is it. A Ball for Daisy. Anyway, so now I'm doing a... I might as well show it to you. So this is my Ball for Daisy. It's very simple. It's about a dog. She loses her ball. Her ball gets broken. She's distraught. And she's happy at the end. It won the Caldecott Award, which was very lucky. It's wonderful, but it's also a... No, you can't rely on it. it's very fluky. But anyway, so now I'm doing a new one. And this one's called Daisy Gets Lost. And this is what I give to my editors. So in this case, it's two. And they looked at it and they said a few things. First of all, they said, too much opening. We don't need all this stuff in the beginning. And I agree with them. She said, let's not make, they thought that her chasing a dog, because there's a dog in the first book, was too much like the first book, and I bought that. They felt that her getting lost with all these people around was not the greatest. So I said, okay, fine. And that was basically all they said. So I made another one. Daisy Gets Lost. And one other thing that they did suggest was, what if she chased a squirrel? And I thought that was a good idea. So we cut straight to the chase this time. She goes off the leash right away. She goes running after the ball. Running after the ball again. And this time, she sees a squirrel up in the tree. Chases the squirrel. Following the squirrel. Getting deeper into the woods, following the squirrel. And now she's starting to look a little nervous, and her owner calls to her. Now she's deep in the forest, and the owner and the dog, Daisy, are looking for each other, looking for each other, looking for each other. Panicking. And then find her.
Use so watercolor?
This is watercolor, yeah. So then it's back to the same. Again, I sent it in, and they said, yeah, like the squirrel. But Lee thought that, first of all, it looks like, on this page, it looks like they're close together, even though I've sort of split it here. And they need to feel like they're quite far apart. And she suggested I try to pull back even further for this middle section so that we really feel like Daisy is lost. So this is my next one. And this one, actually, when you go to have lunch, I think I'm gonna take this down and hand it in to Lee. So same beginning, and I'll just skim over it. This time, obviously, I did it in black and white. And here's the squirrel. And one thing Lee suggested was that Daisy and the squirrel be really eyeball to eyeball on the ground, and I think that's a good idea. And so now she gets lost again, and here she's supposed to be really deep in the forest, and we're going to introduce, her owner actually calling her some words. She's going to call Daisy. Anyway, so this is just how I work, so I thought I would show you that. Of course, then once we get this all approved, then I will paint it, and I'll paint it to size, about this big. It is hard for me, even now, and I've been working in children's books for 20 years. It's still amazingly hard to be rejected, but I think it's helpful that I have been working this long, and I know it is part of the process. And I have to say that even when I started, I felt like I had the sense I was getting slowly better, and both of these books were rejected. And I put them away. I wasn't going to show them to anybody else. And then a friend of mine said, well, why don't you send them to this editor I've mentioned, Richard Jackson, and literally she said he likes weird books, basically based on what she knew that he published. He published strange things. So he liked them, and so it is a matter of, you know, some people like some things, some people like other things. But as far as the rejection goes, I think it is just a part of any kind of artistic endeavor that not everyone's going to like what you do, and you have to be confident in your own self that eventually it will find, your art will find the person it's meant for. Because I do think you do want someone to look at your art. I think we all do.
Yeah. You know.